Thank you all for coming tonight to the Korea Society, and also thank the members for joining us tonight. We are honored to have Dr. Robert D. Mowry join us for the third annual Asia Week lecture on the Buddhist arts of Korea. Dr. Mowry is an educator and an advocate for Asian art in the West. In 2013, Dr. Mowry retired from his roles as senior curator at the Harvard Art Museum, the Alan J. Dorsky Curator of Chinese Art, and head of the Department of Asian Art. He continues to serve as senior lecturer on Chinese and Korean art and Harvard's Department of the History of Art and Architecture. Under his stewardship, Harvard added numerous and very significant works to what already was one of the finest collections of Asian art in the Western world. Dr. Mowry was, until recently, the senior editor of the National Museum of Korea's scholarly journal, the Journal of Korean Art and Archaeology. Dr. Mowry?
Thank you so much. Well, good evening. As always, it's a pleasure to be with you. And I am glad to be with you and glad to be here. And we have a million slides to get through this evening, so why don't we just jump right in. As you know, this evening's lecture is on Buddhist art, Korean Buddhist art, and I think for this crowd, you probably don't need a map to point out where Asia is, not Asia, but Korea, but in case there are any people who are new to the field of Korean art, I would just say that Korea is in, Korea is in Northeast Asia, China over here, the battery seems to be very weak. I'll simply walk over and point. It's in Northeast Asia. Korea is a peninsula there between China on the left and Japan over here. Korea today is divided on the 38th parallel into North Korea, the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, and South Korea. Of course, this division has existed only since World War II and the partition after the period of Japanese colonialism. Korean history. The list of dynasties in Korea, it looks a little bit long, but when you think of the list of Chinese dynasties, the list of Korean dynasties is mercifully short. This evening, we will look a little bit from the Three Kingdoms period, some sculpture, some architecture from the Unified Silla period, and a few paintings and sutras from the Koryŏ dynasty. Buddhism had been the state religion during the Koryŏ dynasty, the arts flourished as they had previously in the Unified Silla period. But with the coming of the Joseon dynasty, the government espoused Neo-Confucianism as the state philosophy. And in the early part of the Joseon dynasty, there was even some persecution of Buddhism. So it didn't flourish at the same level as it had in centuries past. Buddhism didn't die out in Korea, of course, but it wasn't patronized as fully or strongly as it had been before. So the later arts, Buddhist arts in the Joseon dynasty, are not as significant as the earlier ones. So this evening, we will look at some Buddhist sculptures, such as this magnificent meditating bodhisattva. We will look at some Buddhas. We will look at architecture, such as Pulguk-sa from the 8th century, and Sŏkkuram, also from the 8th century. And from the Koryŏ period, we will look at some painting and some Buddhist sutras. Now, to jump right in, since we're talking about Buddhist art, we should probably define who is the Buddha? How do you recognize a Buddha? What were his teachings and such? Well, first of all, in terms of the arts, of how one recognizes a Buddha, first of all, the term Buddha means the enlightened one in Sanskrit. He is an individual who attained enlightenment and then, after he passed on, entered into the state of nirvana. A Buddha is presented in the guise of a Buddhist monk, so that he wears monk's robes. He does not have jewelry. He may wear sandals, or more typically, he will be barefoot. He doesn't wear any jewelry. He has short hair, sometimes a shaven head. other times small snail shell curls of hair, and yet other times he may have short, wavy locks of hair. So as you see here, the characteristics that I described, the robes of a Buddhist monk, as you see there, in this case, it's the short snail shell curls of hair. He is barefoot here, and no jewelry, but the earlobes are elongated. We'll go into the reasons for that in a little bit. He was born a crown prince. He was born Gautama Siddhartha, and he was born in what today is Nepal. We'll come back to this slide in just a second. But where was he born? Well, right in the middle of this circle. Here is Nepal. Here is India. Lumbini, and the Lumbini Grove is where he was born, which is right on the border between Nepal and India today. Of course, the political boundaries were different at the time, but that's where it is today. So Buddhism arose in northern, first in northeastern India, and then in general in northern India. So he was born in the Lumbini Grove, and he was born a crown prince. He was born into the warrior caste, which means that he should have been trained and he should have taken up the life either as a warrior, a military person, or as a statesman, a government official. Now, at the time of his birth, wise men appeared, and they predicted that he would be either a great statesman or a great religious man. And of course, in the religion of the time, it was important that one follow the rules of one's caste. If one was born into the warrior caste, it was obligatory to be a warrior or a statesman, not a religious person. You could be religious, but not a religious priest in that sense, because that was the duty of the Brahmin caste. So his father was terrified that with that prediction, that in fact he might become a religious man. So he kept him within the confines of the palace, provided him with every luxury, everything he could possibly want, so that, and then of course training in the military arts and using a sword and using bow and arrow and such. But then there were the four encounters. That is, when he was in his late 20s, he managed for the first time, according to legend, to leave the palace. He went with his teacher four different times. The four encounters, and it was those encounters that sparked his interest in religious teachings and ultimately his decision to become a monk. So in the four encounters, the first time he and his teacher went out, he encountered a sick man, and he had never witnessed illness before. And he asked his teacher, well, what is this that I'm seeing? And the teacher tells him, well, this person is sick. Everyone eventually gets sick. This will happen to you at some point as well. On the second excursion outside the palace, he encountered an elderly man. Oh, thank you, Daniel. Let's put it down here lest I knock it off. There we go. I encountered an elderly man, and he had never seen age before. He asked, the teacher tells him, well, this is an old man. You too someday will grow old. And on the third of these encounters, he witnessed a corpse, and he had never encountered death before, and so he inquired about that. And so the teacher says, well, everyone, every living being, human, animal, whatever, eventually passes away, and this is what happens after one passes away. Then, on the fourth encounter, he saw a monk, and asked about that. That was explained to him, and as he reflected over the next several days in the palace, he realized that the only individual that he had seen who seemed to be content, at peace with himself and with the world, was the monk. And so he decided to sneak out of the palace, to leave all of that life behind, and to become a monk. And so then you have the great departure. Of course, he couldn't announce that he was leaving, this kind of thing. He had to sneak out, and legend says that a winged horse appeared in the middle of the night, carried him over the walls of the palace, and that way he was able to escape. And then he followed the teachings of several different teachers, some who preached extreme denial, others who preached overindulgence and such, and he finally decided that the way to self-realization was through the middle way. And so Buddhism basically, the essence of his teaching are the Four Noble Truths. That is, all life is suffering. It doesn't mean that people were pessimistic and that kind of thing, but it's tied up with the idea of the samsara cycle, the idea of birth and rebirth. That is, when one dies, it's simply the beginning of the next life, until one escapes from the cycle of birth and rebirth. And this is a major component of all traditional Indian religions, whether it's Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and such. The goal of all those religions is release from the cycle of birth and rebirth. What differentiates the religion is the path or the way to gain release from the cycle of birth and rebirth. And so when we say it's a pessimistic religion, it's, that is to say, it's that life is suffering, one is born to be born, or excuse me, one has to be born and reborn until one escapes. So all life is suffering. Suffering arises from desire. I want this. I want that. I can't leave that behind. So then, the key to eliminate suffering, you have to eliminate desire. And in order to eliminate desire, you must follow the Buddha's Eightfold Path, which has to do with right living and other correct thinking and such, the most important of which, of course, is right meditation, which is a component of all Buddhist traditions, but it's because these on the one hand are very specific, on the other hand things like this are very general. It means that there are different schools of Buddhism, and like any religion, Buddhism has, the theology has evolved over time. Now, what I want to show here, as I mentioned, the characteristics of the Buddha, you have the monk's robes, typically barefoot, the elongated earlobes. The reason for the elongated earlobes, remember that he was born a crown prince. With the great departure, when he left the palace and took up the religious life, he gave up all of his inheritance. He was a crown prince. He gave up any claim to his father's throne. He cast aside all of the riches, all of the land that he would have inherited. In addition, as a born a prince, in that time in India, he would have been given a great deal of jewelry, from bracelets, armlets, necklaces, and very heavy earrings, so of gold. So they probably actually caused a physical distension of the earlobes when he was a child. So that the elongated earlobes stand as a symbol of his rejection of worldly life, of all claim to his father's throne, and to all material goods. And then in this particular case, you have the short wavy locks of hair, and also the distinguishing characteristic of the Buddha that no other deity has is the ushnisha. That's not a treatment of the hair on the top of the head. It is referred to as the ushnisha, and it is a cranial protuberance. That is the symbol of the expanded wisdom that he gained at his enlightenment. The Buddhist symbols, in general, are pretty literal. If you want to somehow encapsulate visually expanded wisdom, what better way to do it than show a larger brain? So they put hair over it to make it look as naturalistic as possible, but it's not part of the hairdo. And what I wanted to show you is that over time, and through different cultures, this is from early India, through China, through Korea, through Japan, these characteristics will remain the same. The style will change from culture to culture, from period to period, but the essential characteristics remain the same. So this is a little bit later, also from India. On the one hand, it looks different. It's bronze rather than stone, but the basic characteristics are there. Monk's robe, elongated earlobe, short hair, and the ushnisha. This one is from China. 8th century. So we've made a huge jump in time. The style is different, but the basic identifying characteristics for the Buddha are the same. Or we go to Korea. This is from 8th century Korea. Characteristics are the same. It's just a matter of a different style, giving it a slightly different appearance. But the short hair there, the ushnisha on the top of the head, the monk's robes, the bare feet, the elongated earlobes. This is... you know now exactly how to identify a Buddha and what marks it as a Buddha. And of course, this is one of the great ones, one of the largest bronze figures ever made in the museum in Kyŏngju from the 8th century. But even though the hands are missing, you immediately recognize it as a Buddha. Now, all of the Buddhas, and there are many different Buddhas, are distinguished one from the other basically by the hand gestures, which are known as Buddha. Actually, I need that to change the slides, even if the I'll just point to it. Thank you. The mudra is a ritual hand gesture symbolizing a particular power, attitude, or action. And so each Buddha has different mudras. Some of them have several different mudras. So Shakyamuni, the historical Buddha, that is the one who lived in the 6th and 5th century BC, basically has a meditation mudra, an enlightenment mudra, the preaching of the first sermon, and of course, just another preaching mudra. And these I will illustrate to you. when he, after he had taken up the religious life and is nearing, after several years of study, and is nearing the period of his enlightenment, he was meditating under a Bodhi tree. And Bodhi is simply a word meaning knowledge. Buddha is part of that, derives from that word, and it's the enlightened one or the knowledgeable one. He was sitting under the Bodhi tree meditating. And when meditating, he's always seated, hands in the lap, usually palm up, the right hand over the left hand. And so whenever you see that, here is one from early India in the region today known as Pakistan. You look some centuries later, a different part of Pakistan, the same, you recognize it as a Buddha, the meditation mudra. Or here's China from the 3rd to 4th century, exactly the same mudra. Whenever you see that, it indicates that he is meditating just before his enlightenment. Then, at the time of his enlightenment, and this of course is from Korea, the great Buddha at Sŏkkuram, but it would be the same gesture called the Bhumisparsa mudra, which is the enlightenment mudra, but it would be the same in any culture, any period. What is happening is, of course, he's been meditating with his hand in his lap. He is achieving enlightenment. He wants someone to witness. There is no one around. So he simply reaches over his right knee and taps the earth to call it to witness. And so in Sanskrit, Bhumisparsa means the earth touching mudra. And that indicates the moment of his enlightenment. So it's a historical Buddha at the time of his enlightenment. Then, after that, you have the first sermon where he enunciates the Four Noble Truths. It's preached in the Deer Park, and it's metaphorically known as the Dharma Chakra Mudra, or the setting of the wheel of law in motion. The Buddhists refer to the canon of Buddhist teachings in general as the wheel of the law, and so setting the wheel of the law in motion simply means referring to the first sermon. So, and then his other preaching mudra is one we've seen before. He may be seated, he may be standing, but the right hand raised in a gesture of do not fear, the left hand lowered in a gift-giving gesture. Together, they indicate that he is preaching. Sometimes it's said that he is preaching the Lotus Sutra, but that's not necessarily the case, but sometimes it probably is. So those are the four mudras associated with Shakyamuni, or the historical Buddha. But there are other Buddhas as well. Now, there are two different types of Buddhism, I think all of you know. The earlier form of Buddhism, sometimes referred to as Hinayana Buddhism, or more appropriately as Theravada Buddhism, is the earliest form of Buddhism. The Buddha was not regarded as a deity, but rather a mortal who lived a very a very saintly life, if you will. But the idea was that if you followed his path, you too could attain enlightenment as the Buddha had attained enlightenment. The earlier form of Buddhism was very much one in which you worked out your own salvation or release from the samsara cycle. But around the 2nd century BC, another form of Buddhism came into being known as Mahayana Buddhism, and this is the form that spread to China, to Korea, to Japan, and was also practiced in India as well. In Mahayana Buddhism, of course, there is Shakyamuni Buddha, but he is seen as just one of many Buddhas, all of whom are regarded as deities. And therefore, we have the idea of many Buddhas. The best known, of course, Shakyamuni, but also Amitabha in Sanskrit, or Amita in Korean and Japanese, He will be dressed exactly the same as Shakyamuni. All the Buddhas are presented in basically the same fashion. It's their mudra or hand gesture that differentiate one from the next. Amitabha looks like that preaching mudra, but his fingers touch. And so it will be the index finger and thumb or the third finger and thumb, whichever. It will be the same fingers on both hands that actually touch. And what those touching fingers indicate is the level of paradise on which he is preaching or meditating. But it's that simple change in gesture to have the fingers touching. Or if he's shown in meditation, the hands will still be in the lap, but instead of overlapping, they'll be side by side, sort of like this, with fingers touching, like that. And so that indicates that it's Amitabha rather than Shakyamuni. And then, of course, there another very important Buddha, particularly in Korea, is Baisajaguru in Sanskrit, or the medicine Buddha. Exactly the same mode of dress, the short hair, the ushnisha on the top of the head. In this case, he's often shown in the earth-touching gesture, but what really identifies him is that in his left hand will be a medicine jar. And of course, the medicine jar is there to indicate physical healing as well as spiritual healing. But this is another very important Buddha throughout all the lands where Buddhism reached, but particularly in Korea. Here's another Korean sculpture of the medicine Buddha. He may be shown standing. The previous one was seated. In this case, the fingers do touch, but what separates him from Amida is the medicine jar in his left hand. So that's another important Buddha. It's not important that you remember all the different Buddhas if you're not specializing in Buddhist art or in Buddhism, but it's just to give you insight as to who are all of these different Buddhas and what do we look for to distinguish one from the next. And so these are the characteristics. The last one of the Buddhas, there are yet others, but the last one that I will show you, who is also popular in Korea, is Varoshana, often known as De-il-yurai in Korean, and he is one of the Buddhas associated with esoteric Buddhism. And typically, his mudra has one finger up with the left hand grasping it, and it's sort of the symbol of the secret or esoteric knowledge that isn't written down in the scriptures or in the sutras, but is passed from teacher to appropriate student. And so this, of course, is from Pulguk-sa and is a very famous image of Vairoshana. Now, apart from the Buddhas, there are several classes of Buddhist deities. The next most important class of deities, if you will, are the bodhisattvas. Bodhi, as in Buddha, again, you know, means knowledge or enlightenment, whatever. If Buddha means the enlightened one, bodhisattva means an enlightened being. Sattva means being, bodhi, knowledge. A bodhisattva, like the Buddha, gained enlightenment, but instead of entering into nirvana, a bodhisattva has postponed entry into nirvana in order to help other sentient beings gain enlightenment. So these, of course, are associated with Mahayana Buddhism, not the older Hinayana Buddhism. The way they are able to assist is that, of course, ultimately, release from the samsara cycle, or cycle of birth and rebirth, is through the through accumulating a store of meritorious karma. Of course, the karma is the accumulated effects of one's deeds, actions, and thoughts. You can have bad karma, in which case you'll be reborn, say, as a mosquito. But if you have good karma, you will advance up the scale. And the way a bodhisattva is able to assist one, if you pray to the bodhisattva, is that because they have gained enlightenment, the bodhisattvas have enormous stores of good karma. If you are a good person, if you pray to them, they can transfer some of their accumulation of good karma to you, thereby assisting in your quest for enlightenment and release from the cycle of birth and rebirth. Of course, in Buddhism, there are paradises, there are hells, this and that, but unlike in the Western traditions where heaven and hell tend to be permanent states once you are consigned to one of them, in Buddhism, these are transient states. So you may be reborn in hell because you were really bad and your karma was really bad, but it's a temporary state. maybe a long temporary state, but you will eventually move out of that into another state. In like manner, if you are born into a, or reborn into a paradise, it is a very happy state, and it's because you've accumulated a lot of good karma. But you can only attain enlightenment from the state of being a human being. Therefore, if you were good enough to be reborn into a paradise, it means that presumably in your next life, you will be reborn as a human being with enough karma that if you continue to do the right things, you will gain enlightenment in that next life. So all of these things, heaven, hell, living on earth, all this and that, they are states that change for an individual over time, and it's one worth working for release from that. So that's what a bodhisattva is. Now, how is a bodhisattva dressed? Well, when the Buddhist theologians early on came up with the idea of a bodhisattva and wanted to represent the bodhisattva in art, the question is, what do we make the bodhisattva look like? Well, the Buddha, of course, as you recall, had been a crown prince in his life before he gained enlightenment and became the Buddha. And so the theologians decided, well, the Buddha himself went from being a prince to a monk and became the Buddha. Let's dress the bodhisattvas as if they are princes, and in a sense, they're spiritual princes, and they sort of follow the Buddha's path. So they are human beings. They wear the robes of a prince, and so you have a dhoti, which is a long rectangular piece of cloth wrapped around the waist, held in place with a cincture. They have scarves. They have a wealth of jewelry. They have long hair that sometimes will be in a high coiffure on the top of the head, or long strands that flow over the shoulders. Just don't mistake a coiffure for the Buddha's Ushnisha. But now let's see what they look like. Of course, the idea of the bodhisattva originated in India. So the earliest representations of the bodhisattva are in India. Here you see the dhoti, the rectangular cloth tied from the waist that hangs down. This bodhisattva is wearing sandals, you would note. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. Scarves that come over the shoulder. It's not a tailored garment. All kinds of jewelry. And you see necklaces, armlets. Sometimes they have anklets. And heavy earrings of the type that presumably would have caused the distension of the Buddha's earlobes. Here we're jumping from, 2nd century AD to China in the 8th century. And even though it looks much different, you realize the characteristics are there. The dhoti from the waist down tied with an elegant ribbon. The scarves that flutter down here, the jewelry. And then the very high coiffure up here. Sometimes they might even wear a crown. When we look to Korea, this is a very austere presentation of the bodhisattva, but the necklaces, the dhoti, the bare upper chest, this one wearing a crown atop the head. And so you recognize that this is a bodhisattva. This is a magnificent representation of a bodhisattva at Sŏkkuram, which we'll discuss as an architectural cave temple a little bit later. But this is the image, a relief directly behind that monumental image of the Buddha. But again, the same characteristics that we saw before with a very elaborate crown atop the head. Of course, when we come to the Koryŏ period, I've been talking about sculpture up to this point, but the same characteristics hold true for painting as well. Whether from India, from China, from Korea, from Japan. It's a little bit later, and so it's 14th century, and so it's a little more elaborate, but the presentation of the bodhisattva with magnificent robes, a very high coiffure, and an elaborate headdress as well. Now, what I wanted to introduce here is that we also, in the same way that there are many Buddhas who are identified, there are many generic bodhisattvas, if you will, but there are also many specific bodhisattvas who are identified by name and function, if you will, in the sutras or the sacred texts of Buddhism. This is the bodhisattva in Sanskrit, Avalokiteshvara, in Chinese, Guanyin, in Korean, Kwanseam Bosal, in Japanese, Kannon. The bodhisattva of compassion. And the way we recognize Kwanseam Bosal, is because there is a little image of Amitabha or Amida Buddha in the crown. Hard to see here, but in the detail, perhaps you can see it. This is because this particular bodhisattva is believed to be a spiritual emanation, if you will, from Amitabha. And that's why Amitabha is represented in the crown. So when this bodhisattva is represented together with a Buddha, this one goes with Amitabha because it's a son of Amitabha, if you will, but more appropriately, a spiritual emanation from Amitabha. Now, this, is, of course, is one of the most famous Korean sculptures. This is from the 7th century. We're not quite sure whether it's from Paekje or from Silla, but definitely from the southern part of the Korean peninsula. But in terms of its iconography, we think that it probably represents Maitreya. Maitreya is a bodhisattva, but Maitreya is the bodhisattva who will become the next Buddha when another Buddha appears. Now, because this image is so famous, everyone thinks that this type originated in Korea. It actually originated in India, traveled through China, comes to Korea, but the Koreans do it with such grace and such elegance that it rightly is a symbol of Korea. This is another image of Maitreya that you can see right here in New York. It's in the Metropolitan Museum collection. But when I say it originated in India, here is one in the Gandharan style from the 2nd, 3rd century. The bodhisattva is seated with one leg pendant, one folded into the lap, but the hand up and more or less resting against the shoulder. Against the cheek. Here is a Chinese image from the late 6th century, seated in exactly the same fashion. In this case, the hand definitely touches the cheek. So this is an old established iconography, the meditating bodhisattva, which finds its way to Korea and then finds expression in the 17th century in one of the most elegant images ever produced. What I would remind you in looking at something like this, despite the interconnections between India, China, China, Korea, Korea, Japan, the Korean sculpture at its very finest, just like Korean celadons at their very finest, are every bit the technical and aesthetic equal of anything produced in China or Japan. And this certainly well illustrates that. What I would also point out with this is that there was a huge amount of influence in this period from Korea on Japan. So that this is an image produced in Japan about the same time under Korean influence. In fact, relations between Korea and Japan were not so strained at that time, and a number of Korean sculptors were actually working in Japan at that time. Buddhism was introduced into Japan from Korea, and this attests to the strong connections. This, of course, is in gilt bronze, this one carved in wood. They're not absolutely identical, but of course they are very, very close in style and appearance. Here are two details from the Japanese one in wood. Now, we've discussed the main types of deities, the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas, how to recognize them, who some of the individual Buddhas, some of the individual Bodhisattvas are. I want to remind you that so often when we are in a museum or in a commercial gallery here in New York, for example, we see Buddhist images one by one by one, put into a case. It's a beautiful thing. It's well described, with luck, in the label. But what we often forget is that in most cases they are presented as groups of images, not originally as just individuals. That can be too, but in general they are presented in groups. So in very simple, straightforward fashion, you may simply have the Buddha, which you would recognize as the Buddha, flanked on either side by two attendant bodhisattvas. Keep in mind that the presentation in the Buddhist arts is always very hierarchical, so that the more important the deity, the larger it will be. Therefore, not just in India, but in China, Korea, Japan as well, the Buddha will be larger by far than the attendant bodhisattvas. And if there's some other figures, like guardian figures or monks or Buddhist disciples, they will be yet smaller and tucked in the spaces in between. Keep that in mind. You may wonder, why are the lions there? Well, they become something of a symbol of Buddhism, something of a symbol of Shakyamuni. Shakya was the clan name for Gautama Siddhartha. He became known as the sage of the Shakya clan. That's what Shakyamuni means, the sage of the Shakya clan. But in addition, he was also known as the lion of the Shaka clan for his accomplishments. And so in that sense, the lions become one of the symbols of Buddhism, and they often turn up not just with Shakyamuni, but sometimes with other Buddhas as well. Or in this one in from Korea as well, you have a Buddha flanked on either side by a bodhisattva. I'm just saying, keep in mind that they're presented, we'll talk about these in more detail later, but they're presented in groupings. Or here is a very elaborate one. This one, Chinese, dated to 524 by inscription. It's in the Met, so you can see it there. But you have the Buddha in the center. Then there are attendant bodhisattvas. They're guardian figures. There are angelic figures around here. This is one of the very few of these gilt bronze altarpieces. In height, it's about this high, what, 2 feet, something like that. Very few of these remain intact, but this is one spectacular example. And of course, Korean altarpieces would have been similar originally. Or here's a gorgeous one from Korea, from the 8th century. Again, a Buddha, and this is that turning of the wheel of the law, preaching the first sermon. You would recognize the mudra, with two slightly smaller bodhisattvas on either side. And that, again, is one of the most... and Koreans are particularly fond of open work, whether in ceramic vessels of the period, but also in this beautiful mandorla. A mandorla is simply a full-body halo, as you see there. Very beautiful, very graceful. Or in the groupings like this, in China. This is from Dunhuang. A Buddha, bodhisattvas on either side, yet more bodhisattvas there. Disciples, this is Ananda, the young disciple, Kaishapa, the old disciple, looking like the elderly man that he was, and yet subsidiary figures over here. And notice that usually it's not just sculpture, but it's an ensemble of sculpture with wall paintings and such. That's from China. This is at Pulguk-sa, and you suddenly realize it's all part of the same fabric. You have the sculptures, the Buddha, you have the bodhisattvas on either side, you have yet other figures here in another material, but combined with the effect of the wall paintings behind it. So it really is an ensemble. Things are hierarchically arranged. And when you see something in a museum, it's important, once you've appreciated it as an individual work of art, to try to see what the original context might have been. Now, apart from the deities and who they are, and the different groupings of images and such, wanted to talk a little bit about the material. Of course, ones that we see in this country for Korea and for China and Japan are often gilt bronze, as we have here. But occasionally, particularly for a royal commission, a few images were made in solid gold, like this small but exquisite piece from the 8th century in the National Museum of Korea. Or alternatively, sometimes like this one, this is solid silver, but to make it as appealing and as appropriate for presentation to a deity as possible, the silver has been coated with gold, so that a very special piece. Less so in Korea, but sometimes in China, particularly sometimes in Tibet, you may have an image that's done completely in silver, with only details, the scarves, the jewelry and such are gilded, and sometimes even inset with jewels, as we see here. But that's more typical of the Tibetan tradition. But even though we're familiar with the use of gold, and sometimes with jewels, with bronze and metal sculptures, we often forget that all of the stone sculptures from India, from China, from Korea, were painted and sometimes gilded originally. So what you're seeing here in the background, all of that's gold leaf. It's not dirt on the surface. Keep in mind, this was true for Greek and Roman sculpture as well, in the same way that the Parthenon was originally completely painted with colors that today we would probably find rather garish, blues, oranges, things like that. But also medieval cathedrals in Europe, the great Gothic cathedrals, the Romanesque cathedrals and such, they were all painted. It's simply the paint has worn away, we don't see it. But that was true of Buddhist sculpture as well, in stone, in clay, in plaster. This is one of the rare pieces where the robe is still saffron in color. And look at the detail of the painting on the pedestal. So keep that in mind too. When you see a stone or wooden sculpture, it was originally colored. It wasn't meant for you to appreciate the beautiful marble or the beautiful grain of the wood. That's something that we see in the modern world, but was not part of the ancient aesthetic. But stone sculptures too, like this one from China, There is gilding on the flesh portions of the figures, the bodhisattvas and the Buddha. There are still traces of painting on this particular sculpture. And very few sculptures from, and of course there are the great ensembles like this where the walls, the image and such are all painted. But in Korea, at Sŏkkuram, for example, or other stone sculptures, the painting is all gone, but they originally certainly were painted. We know not only from textual descriptions, but through analysis of the pieces. Little bits of pigment are found here and there, and things like that. Now, in terms of style, its evolution, its transmission from one place to another, this is a Chinese image from the 3rd to 4th century. For China, it stands as one of the very earliest iconic images of the Buddha. Now, of course, Buddhism, as we know, came into being in India, in northeastern India, on the border of Nepal, like we saw up there. But how did it find its way to China? Well, it was introduced into China around the time of Christ, coincidentally, in the West. And of course, much of the transmission from India to China happened over the well-known Silk Route. So that would end up there coming into China. Secondarily, there were also sea routes, but that's the way it made its way to China. Now, when we look at early Chinese images, suddenly we realize they are based very strongly, the earliest ones, on Indian images. A little bit later, but this is a very small image. You can see it in the Metropolitan Museum. It's only about this big. This kind of image could have been carried in bronze, something like that, to China. It was seen there as Buddhism began to be practiced. They needed temples, they needed images for their altars, for their personal shrines and things like that, and they imitated these. Of course, in the earliest of the Indian images, those from the northwest, what today would be Pakistan, there was a great deal of Greco-Roman influence. One, because Alexander the Great had penetrated into that area, and after his death, a small contingent of his people remained there, maintaining their own traditions. But that area also maintained strong trade ties with ancient Rome, so that you have the Roman toga, that kind of thing, suddenly ending up on a Chinese Buddha. So in China, this is from the 3rd to early 4th century. There it is alone. By the 6th century, early 6th century, when this was made, the style has evolved. So that it's somewhat more elegant. It still reflects its origins in India and distant echoes with the Greco-Roman world, but with these strong swallowtail ends to the drapery, if you will. You put them side by... and then it's that style that is introduced into Korea. Buddhism is introduced into Korea in the 4th century. in the north, in what was the Koryŏ kingdom of the Three Kingdoms period, also into the Pekche kingdom there in the southwest. The Silla was the last of the three kingdoms to adopt Buddhism. But this is the earliest extant gilt bronze image of the Buddha from Korea. It has an inscribed date that corresponds to the year 539, and when you put it side by side with a Chinese image of the same period, you see how this kind of image, with the swallowtail drapery, the very elongated figure, has influenced the development over here. Even the lotus pedestal is very similar. This one originally perhaps had the kind of altar or table-like stand, which is now missing. But you see the lower part, the upside-down lotus blossom, this part here, is very similar to what you have there. So in the same way that the Chinese were learning from the Indians, and their first images were very much in the Indian style, when Koreans first started making images, they were learning from the Chinese, and you see the relationship there. Or here are ones from about the same period, from the first half of the 6th century, that are done in clay, that is fired clay, so they're earthenware, made in molds. But there you see those characteristics with the upside-down lotus blossom, the elegant attenuation of the figure, the swallowtail ends to the drapery, and things like that. And then, as we move to the 7th century, the Koreans have, the style has matured so that they're expressing themselves in a style that meets their own aesthetic needs in a piece like this, which, even though the origins of the meditating bodhisattva stretch to China and all the way back to India, the style here is uniquely Korean very mature and very beautiful at that. Then, this is going back to India, but it's to say that monks from China and occasionally from Korea were always going to India. They wanted to study Buddhism at its source. So as styles evolved, that is artistic styles, evolved in India, new styles would be carried back to China, have their impact there. And this is sort of the classic Indian style, the Gupta style, which is an age of great refinement in India. And this would date to the late 5th century, probably 475, something like that. You see how that's now picked up in a style from a little bit later here, whereas the earlier styles, with the attenuated figures, the swallowtail drapery folds and such, they tended to mask the anatomy of the body. Sometimes they even masked the presence of the body underneath the robes, with the artist taking great delight in the drapery itself. With the Gupta style, you see that the robes cling very tightly, are revealing not only the presence of the body, but the anatomy of the body as well. And that's happening over here. If you don't see it there, at least you see the robes clinging down here, so that the legs are very carefully articulated. The robe is going over the foot, and yet you can clearly make out all the details of the foot through the robe. And then, when they expose part of the body, they detail at least some of the anatomical features, with the chest, the pectorals separated from the abdomen down below, and the two halves of the chest separated. So this is reflecting renewed influence coming in from India. That then finds its way, and here we're dealing with the unified Silla period, where Silla has, it's no longer three kingdoms, but for the first time, the peninsula has been unified governmentally, and the center is in Kyŏngju down there in the southeast. But then you begin to have styles of this particular type, where once again, doesn't look exactly like the Chinese style, but you see the influence, with part of the chest exposed, with the drapery clinging tightly, at least to the legs, reveal their presence and their structure. And of course, the great Buddha at Sŏkkuram, from the mid to second half of the 8th century, and we'll see more of this later, but the great Buddha there is in that same style. Put these side by side, and you can see that one is not a copy of the other, yet the direction of the influence is quite clear. Now, having talked about Sŏkkuram, we'll sort of leave sculpture behind, not completely, but we'll talk a little bit about architecture, and this introduces us to Sŏkkuram, this great cave temple in Korea. And so there's a long pathway. You enter through this gate. You walk along. It's beautiful in all seasons. This was taken in the mists and rain, going onto Sŏkkuram, it's built into a hill so that partly you're walking uphill and then there are stairs to climb to actually reach the temple itself. That is the temple back there, the grass-covered mound. Of course, there always have been buildings there, although these are replacement buildings from the 20th century. And this is looking directly at the temple there. Now, of course, as I will show you later, this is modeled after cave temples in China and ultimately in India. The big difference is that the cave temples in China and further afield in India were carved into the living rock. That is, they were carved into cliffs of either sandstone or limestone, which are relatively soft stones. There are no hills of that type in Korea. Korea, it just seems to be solid granite. And it would be impossible to carve a cave temple into a hillside of granite. Therefore, what really differentiates Sŏkkuram as a cave temple from those in China or India is that it is a temple imitating a cave temple, but is made of cut blocks of granite, cut blocks of stone. First of all, the ground plan, it's small by standards of China and India, but given the material, it's quite an accomplishment. Of course, it was done under royal patronage, and so it's done at the highest level. But you have a foyer, if you will. It constricts here. We'll see pictures. Then there is this circular area with the great Buddha seated there. And that one gorgeous relief bodhisattva that I showed you is directly behind the Buddha. Looking in the elevation, you have the narthex or the atrium. You have the constricted area, and then you have the main part of the temple, which is circular, with the relief panels and the great Buddha there. And notice the dome. It really is a dome constructed with interlocking blocks of stone. So looking in, this is the narthex area, if you will, every one with relief sculptures. And remember, this is done with cut blocks of granite, so they were carved outside, set into place, and you see the way they come together, and then the Buddha there under the main dome. Here you look up into the dome, and you see how well it was done. You see the figures surrounding the Buddha, smaller figures in niches there, and then the Buddha with the halo behind him. Another view of the Buddha. And here is that beautiful sculpture that I showed you before, directly behind the Buddha, his face. And again, this is done in Korea in the 8th century, but this is every bit the technical and aesthetic of equal of the very best sculpture done in China at the time. In some ways, it's an even greater accomplishment because it's done in granite, which is such a hard stone, whereas the ones in China tend to be limestone or sandstone, both of which are very soft stones, or occasionally in marble, but the Chinese virtually never work in granite. And here is that one, which is, again, one of the great masterpieces, not only of Korean art, of Korean sculpture, but one of the great masterpieces of world art in a very, very low relief. Now, this is just one picture of Sŏkkuram. We look at it today, we assumed it hadn't changed over the centuries. But in fact, keep in mind, it was built in the 8th century. It was used as an active temple well into the Koryo period. But when Buddhism was pushed aside with the coming of the Joseon dynasty, where Neo-Confucianism was the state religion, the temple was basically abandoned. The dome collapsed. Much of it collapsed. But fortunately, the Buddha was not damaged. Most of the sculptures were not damaged, fortunately. One of the virtues of working in granite. Now, when I said, where did the idea of a cave temple come from? Well, this is one of the early Indian cave temples. It originally would have had a wooden front to it, a facade and things like that, but carved into the living rock. Why did they have cave temples? The simple answer is we don't know for sure, but we think it's probably, on the one hand, of dealing with the idea of sort of universal throughout the world of Mother Earth. But in addition, apart from that, the early Buddhist monks who had to beg for every meal, who had to beg for every scrap of cloth to stitch together to make a robe, had no fixed housing. There were not dormitories, there were not temples where they could stay. They took refuge in caves. And so the earliest worship services were just in natural caves where they were taking refuge. And so probably those two factors are what led to the idea of the cave temple. So that's the entrance. When you look at the ground plan, some of the Indian cave temples are really quite immense. And then at the far end, there's the focal point of worship, which is a stupa. It is a form that's been transformed into a mode for Buddhist worship, but it originated as a burial mound, a royal burial mound, and because the Buddha's ashes supposedly were buried in a mound like that, it will have relics in it, and is a bit like the cross in Christianity, that kind of thing becomes a great focus for Buddhist worship. One worshiped by circumambulating the stupa. Looking into it, this is the inside of that temple, again, carved from the living rock. These are wooden members put in to help make sure that it doesn't collapse, but that's the stupa at the end of the cave temple. Of course, there are cave temples in China. This is the great temple complex at Longmen. There was the great one built in the late 7th century under imperial patronage. But you can see here at Longmen, there are some 400 small cave temples carved into the limestone face there. This is a close-up view of that one. The front part of it has collapsed. And so, of course, there was a temple that extended out. But that's the back with the great Buddha, the bodhisattvas, the monks, Ananda, Kashyapa. And there you can really see the hierarchical presentation. The Buddha is the largest, the bodhisattvas next, the disciples even smaller. or in Dunhuang, again, a cave temple complex in Gansu province in northwestern China. Now, leaving Sŏkkuram behind, we'll look a little bit at Pulguk-sa, which is very near Sŏkkuram, I mean, a couple of miles away, but in the same vicinity, in Kyŏngju, also built in the mid-8th century, also under royal patronage. So as at Sŏkkuram, today at least, one enters through a gateway and one has a short walk to the temple itself. And here, one of the great features of Pulguk-sa is this wonderful set of two stone bridges. They have nothing to do per se with Buddhism, but because it's built as a great royal temple under royal patronage, this was the royal entrance up the stairways into the temple. And then the temple itself is situated on a terrace at the top, reached by that stairway. Simply another view looking at the stairway and the marvelous stonework, the marvelous architecture. This is looking directly up. It's on two levels. The lower level is called the Blue Cloud Bridge, the upper level, the White Cloud Bridge. And then you enter the temple precincts through the gate of purple haze, if you will. And that's the entrance, the gateway, with the sign identifying the gateway. With an aerial view, this is what we were looking at. Here are the stone bridges, the blue bridge or the blue cloud bridge, the white cloud bridge, the gate of purple haze. And then you move into the precincts proper. This is the main image hall where the Shakyamuni Buddha is seated there. You have the two pagodas. Many Korean pagodas are small. Some were great wooden pagodas, as you might expect in China or Japan, but Korea also refined the art of the small stone pagoda, which are very beautiful. So that's the main image hall with Shakyamuni. This is the main lecture and meditation hall there. This is a pavilion for Kwanseyam Bosal, that bodhisattva with Amitabha in the crown. This is a hall specifically for Vairochana, the one who has that particular mudra. And this is a hall for Amida. And so you have all of those different Buddhas there, each with his own hall, and accoutrements and sets of bodhisattvas. So this is the plan. This is the main gateway, the blue and white cloud bridges, a secondary gateway over there, the main image hall, the two pagodas in stone, the lecture slash meditation hall, that's for the bodhisattva Kwanseyam, that's for Vairochana, priest offices and things like that, and that's the one for Amitabha. So the layout is standard for Korea, but a little bit different from what we see in Japan or China. This is looking down again, the hall for Amitabha, the main hall, the bridges coming up here, and the two stone pagodas, which are really beautiful. This is one. This particular style is unique to Korea. We don't see it in China. We really don't see it in Japan, although it's this kind of thing in Japan that evolved into one of the temple lanterns. And sometimes the fire would have been, in the sense of candles and such, would have been burnt here as well. But it really is a pagoda, dabota, rather than a lantern per se. And this is the kind of stone pagoda that is typical of Korea, very refined presentation of the pagoda. One finds it not just in Kyŏngju, but one finds it throughout South Korea, over several different centuries. Another view, and that's looking back towards the Daung Jan, or main image hall with Shakyamuni. You go under the sign through the doorway, and here is the image of Shakyamuni there. This is looking at the Vairochana in a different hall, but once again, just to give a feel for the temple. That's the way it looks today. Brace yourself. In the same way that Sŏkkuram collapsed, this is what Pulguk-sa looked like in the early 20th century. So what we see today has been a reconstruction. It's the correct plan, all of this and that. The bridge is there. It's been very faithful, using the original materials, reassembled and such. Because of the Chosun dynasty, because of Neo-Confucianism and such, it was simply abandoned. But you can see, even though all else had fallen apart, the pagoda is there, that one. Then they began the rebuilding. Here's the way it looked in the 1930s, the 1950s, and a beautiful snowy scene today. Of course, it's beautiful in all seasons, every season, but in winter, it has its own charm. couple more things and we will be finished with the lecture. This has completely disappeared, but I wanted to point out that one of the great East Asian temples was in Korea in the 8th, 9th, and 10th centuries. This is the Hwangryong-sa, the Imperial Dragon Temple, which in its the time it was built, this was the largest pagoda in all of Asia. Korea was very wealthy in the Three Kingdoms period, in the Unified Silla period, and into the Koryo period as well. So this not only had the Grand Pagoda, now completely gone, it was burned by the Mongols in 1238, but it was also a great center of learning. And so another marvel. This is a reconstruction of what the city of Kyŏngju, which was the capital of Unified Silla, looked like in the beginning of the 9th century. There is the temple complex of Hwangryong-sa, and you see all the low buildings and things like that as Kyŏngju was then, and you see the immense size of the pagoda in this scale model. They're doing excavations there. Of course, it covered more territory than this, but this is a portion that has been excavated. This is the foundation for that giant pagoda. All of these columns, well, they're not really columns, they are stone rests on the ground, which I will show you there, to receive the columns that supported the pagoda. And so just from this, you can see how immense that pagoda was. See the circles there? That's where the cylindrical post came down and sat right in that circle. But you get an idea of how immense that was. What I'm showing you here, I'm going to show you a detail that remains from that building. This is one of the roof ridge ends that's in the Kyŏngju National Museum. If you stand next to it, it is more than 6 feet tall. It's as tall as a person. What it is in this land, when you look back here, when I say a roof ridge end, it's one of these things. It's just an elegant accompaniment for a graceful end to the roof. See it there, some other buildings as well. But when you see it again, you realize it's gigantic, and it gives you a sense of scale as to how big the other buildings were in addition to the pagoda itself. Another one of the great marvels from the 8th century is this large bell, which, of course, originally was with the temple, but now is at the Kyŏngju National Museum in its own little pavilion, as you see there. This is one of the largest bronze bells ever cast, again, attesting to the technical and aesthetic achievement of the people of Silla. Of course, the bell is struck from the outside, has a beautiful sound to it. And the surface is embellished so that you have these wonderful, it's the same one, it's two different slides, it's hard to capture it so it looks good, two different slides of the same thing, but these wonderful apsarasas are little angelic-like figures that hold their hands in an attitude of adoration. They're a little bit worn from people touching them over the centuries, but they're as beautiful, particularly at the top. Floral decoration of peonies and other flowers, where it's so tall that no one's touched it, and so they've remained in very, very good condition. The last thing, there are very few Koryo paintings extant, but we'll look at just a couple of Koryo paintings. We've been looking at things most recently, Pulguk-sa and Sŏkkuram, in the right around Kyŏngju, which was the capital of Unified Silla from 668 down until 935. But in 935, that dynasty was overthrown, the Koryo dynasty established, with its capital at modern Kaesong, which today is just across the 38th parallel in North Korea, Seoul here, Kaesong is there. And the great glories, of course, of the, this just shows you the change in size from Silla to Koryo being a little bit larger, and then that is the border of modern Korea today. The Koryo period is most famous around the world for the beautiful celadons produced, particularly in the 12th, 13th century, which are every bit the equal, again, technically and aesthetically, of the very best Chinese celadons of the day. But it was a period of great refinement, and the paintings are just as refined. For Koryo painting, it's basically only Buddhist painting that survives. Secular painting of the day does not survive. Even then, there are only something like 150 Koryo paintings known worldwide. So they are exceptionally rare. Very refined, of course, done under Chinese influence, but they're executed with even more elegance and even more lavishly, with a liberal use of gold, or a very generous use of gold throughout. What you're seeing here is not flesh-toned pigment, but it's gold. It's not gold leaf, as the Japanese used. Rather, it's gold that has been ground to a fine powder, mixed with a binder, that is to say, basically an animal hide glue from boiling hooves, hides, and things like that, mixing it with the gold, the powdered gold, and then painting it on in the appropriate places. Chinese didn't use very much gold for things like this. The Japanese used gold leaf. The Koreans used powdered gold in a binder. So you see it in the flesh portions, you see it in the decorative elements on the robes, you see it in the halos and mandorlas. Again, a hierarchical presentation, Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, and because there's only one Buddha in any given presentation, but an equal number of Bodhisattvas, ultimately you will have an odd number of figures. Occasionally you have figures, Bodhisattvas or a Buddha, that is presented in isolation, such as this so-called water moon, because of the water down below, and it's not really a moon up above, but because the halos look a little bit like a moon, sometimes referred to as a water moon. These are quite interesting. If you look over here, there is a kundika vessel, Kwanseyam is often shown in association with a willow branch, because the willow branch, and nothing to do with India in this case, but in Chinese medicine, the willow branch it figured in the pharmacopoeia of Chinese medicine, because, you know, willow bark, the bark from the willow tree, contains acetylsalicylic acid, which is the active ingredient of aspirin. So the willow was used as an analgesic in ancient Chinese medicine, which was also carried over into Korea. So the willow branch became a symbol of healing, both physical healing and spiritual healing, so that this bodhisattva of compassion is often shown with a willow branch. In this case, the kundika, which is a vessel for holy water, if you will, is being used as a vase for the willow branch. Now, this is what is actually being shown there, not a metal container. Everyone thinks, oh, it must be a patinated bronze. You think, who would dare present a patinated bronze to a deity? If you're going to present a metal vessel, it must be silver, gold, something like that. The fact that it's green is one of the refined celadons of the day. So it's a vessel like this that is being shown there. You don't see the spout, but it's a vessel like this with a willow branch coming through it. Now, the mode of presentation is based on Chinese images of the bodhisattva from the 8th century, Wu Daozi, where the bodhisattva is changed from this kind of regal being that we saw before in the clothing of a prince to something like this. That one is standing. This is a rubbing made after a famous painting, that kind of thing. The original painting is long gone, but this is the closest kind of thing we have to it. But you see the kind of robes, the headdress with kind of a veil that comes down from the head, but even the headdress is very, very similar as when we put these side by side. You see how it's been influenced by Chinese painting of the 8th century, but then it becomes ever more refined with the beautiful colors. And first this one to show how the image of the bodhisattva has changed from this type of image with just the dhoti to a more Chinese style of dress and a more, perhaps more welcoming image of the bodhisattva. And then that style is transferred into the Korean painting tradition for the bodhisattva in the Koryŏ dynasty. But when we put the faces, what I wanted to show you, not the face so much, but when I say painted with great refinement, we get this kind of seeing through layers. So the richness of the bodhisattva's robes, some things decorated in gold, such as the roundels here, others picked out in white, the decoration on the red portion of the robe. But notice how one sees through this transparent white veil to the underlying red robe, or sees through the veil to see the arm, to see jewelry and things like that. A level of finesse that we don't find in China or Japan, but is done just absolutely perfectly in Korea. And it's just to say that in the same way that the kundika appeared as a vase there in that 8th century bodhisattva relief carving, this bodhisattva is holding a kundika, but this time it's a vase for a lotus blossom instead of for a willow branch. The last couple of images I will show you are of sutras, and these are also some of the marvels of Koryo Buddhist art. Embellished sutras on indigo-dyed paper, occasionally on purple-dyed paper, were done in India, China, Korea, Japan. But those from Korea are particularly luxurious. In the frontispiece, which is the opening illustration to the sutra, the artist really wanted to cover every single inch of the paper with decoration. Typically, it will be a Buddha flanked by bodhisattvas and such. But in most paintings, when you see a Buddha and attendant bodhisattvas, they're facing out at you. And sometimes they do in sutras as well. But often in a sutra, the Buddha faces the faces the text of the sutra, presumably because that is the text that the Buddha is preaching. So he looks here. These are the words that he is saying. Or alternatively, perhaps he is simply looking, admiring, and respecting the text that follows. Like the gold in the Koryo paintings, this is done with powdered gold mixed with a binder and painted onto the surface. That mixture is extremely viscous, and so this is a very difficult kind of painting to do. In the same manner, this is silver, it's not white. It's powdered silver mixed with a binder and applied to the indigo paper. Now, this is a very nice one, but, and this is the cover, the front cover with the title, the back cover, of course, both of them embellished with lotus blossoms. But when you get into the really complex ones, frontispieces, you get ones like this. In this particular case, asymmetrical arrangement, the Buddha does face outward. There you can see it blown up just a little bit. But you can really see how in the Korean tradition in the 14th century, they wanted to embellish every bit of surface of the paper, even with the most magnificent of borders. So we will end there. But that takes us over almost 1,000 years from the Three Kingdoms period, introduction of Buddhism, different deities, evolution of styles, painting, and I can't go on any longer. Thank you for coming.
Please join me in giving Dr. Mowry one more hand of applause.
Yeah, we're way past our time. Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here.
And thank you for joining us this Asia Week. Be sure to visit the Korea Society's website, www.koreasociety.org, to learn how you can support our programs through membership. Have a good evening.